As we continue our study, as we've been on Wednesday evening now for a considerable amount of time, we're looking at lessons that we can learn from those in the Old Testament, because we know the things that are written aforetime are written for our learning. And that certainly the example of all of these characters that we're studying, there are things that we can learn both of a positive as well as of a negative nature. So our study tonight concerns Elijah. And Elijah was a great, he was a influential prophet of God. And we know that he performed several miracles in his lifetime, and we'll be looking at some of them this evening. However, as influential and as great of a prophet as he was not Superman. In fact, Elijah was a person like you, like me. In fact, James tells us in James 5, verse 17, that Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. So in all of the things that we will be considering about him in our study, let's always realize that Elijah was just a man. He was a man that was determined to do God's will. And there were those moments that he was greatly encouraged, and there were those moments that he was greatly discouraged. And I think that helps us to see how that we are truly, in many ways, like him. We're introduced to Elijah in our study last week of Ahab. He was introduced to us in 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1. And the statement is made concerning him that he is Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead. What that simply means is he was from Tishbe or Tishbe, and I was unable to find anyone that was really able to pinpoint that location on a map. So it's one of those places that we do not know the whereabouts of Tishbe or Tishbe. In that first appearance that we studied concerning Elijah, he confronted Ahab with the prophecy from God that there would be no rain until Elijah would give the word for there to be rain. And all of that was because of the wickedness of Ahab and the wickedness that Ahab had influenced Israel, of which he was the king over, to commit. And two, as we mentioned last week, it seems that from the moment that we were introduced to Elijah, from that moment onward, he seems to spend most of his life at the mercy of others that hated him. But what we see is that through all of this, God provided and God watched over Elijah. And after delivering the message to Ahab, God tells Elijah to go to the east side of Jordan to a brook called Cherith or Cherith. And there he was able to drink from the water of the brook with God feeding him by sending ravens with bread and water, or bread and meat each evening. And that brings us to chapter 17, verse 8. For there in verses 8 through 24, we see Elijah and the widow of Zarephath. When the brook dried up that Elijah was told to go to, Elijah is then told by God to go to a widow in this city of Zarephath. And looking at it on the map, it would have been somewhere in the vicinity of about a 120-mile journey. And when he arrives, he asked her for a drink of water and for a morsel of bread to eat. And here's what she informs him in verse 12. I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin, and a little jar of oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. In all probability, this was brought on by the drought that was occurring and had been going on now for quite some time. Because why I say that is due to Elijah's promise that he makes to her. He says in verse 14, "The bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth." So in this destitute situation, and the fact of the matter being that she was a widow, that conjures up in her minds that really she's struggling, if it even weren't not for the drought. Being a widow at that period of time certainly was a difficult chore, and obviously she had a son at home. So we can only really imagine what went through this widow's mind when Elijah tells her that your flour shall not be used up, nor will your oil run dry. But it seems that she trusts Elijah's God, because she goes ahead and she prepares the bread and they eat. And Elijah stays with the widow and her son for the rest of the drought, however long of a period that might be. But even during that time, the woman's faith is tested a second time. And this is with the death of her son. And she questions why that had to happen. In verse 17, she says, "What have I done to you, O man of God? Have you come to me to bring my son, sin rather, to remembrance and to kill my son?" So I don't think that we could say that we would have hardly reacted any differently. She's having a hard time of it as it is. Elijah has blessed her with the staples, the necessary things of life, but now her son dies. And here's Elijah's response. "Give me your son." So he took him out of her arms and carried him to the upper room where he was staying and laid him on his own bed. Then he cried out to the Lord and said, "O Lord, my God, have you also brought tragedy on the widow with whom I lodge by killing her son?" And he stretched himself out on the child three times and cried out to the Lord and said, "O Lord, my God, I pray, let this child's soul come back to him." Then the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came back to him, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper room into the house and gave him to his mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." Then the woman says to Elijah, "Now by this I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is the truth." The next thing that we see, and the one thing maybe most of all that sticks out in our mind concerning the story of Elijah, is him and the prophets of Baal. They meet at Mount Carmel. And this is in chapter 18. It was after 3.5 years of drought that God tells Elijah to go to Ahab. And Elijah challenges the prophets of Baal and Ashtoreth to a contest to see whose God would answer who. And there were 450 prophets of Baal. There were 400 prophets of Ashtoreth. So we're talking a large audience of just prophets 850 to be exact, not counting whatever the number of the children of Israel that might have been gathered. So, when Ahab sees Elijah, he says in verse 17, "Is that you, O troubler of Israel?" And in the same verse 18, here's Elijah's reply, "I have not troubled Israel, but you and your father's house have, in that you have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and have followed the Baals." And with that, Elijah challenges the people, including Ahab, to choose between God and Baal. In verse 21, he said, "How long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him." But look at the rest of the verse. "But the people answered him, not a word." And so Elijah gives instructions as to what to do. He instructs them to the fact that there would be two bulls that would be taken. One would be chosen for themselves. It would be cut in pieces. It would be laid on the wood, but there'd be no fire put under the wood or under the sacrifice either. Elijah was to prepare the other bull, lay it on the wood, but put no fire under it. And then they were to call on the name of their gods. And Elijah would call on the name of the Lord, and whichever God answered by fire, Elijah said, "He is God." And all of the people agreed to those instructions. So the people that get it, they prepare their bull, and the prophets of Baal spend all day in calling to Baals, cutting themselves, going through, you can imagine, chants, everything in the world. And all of the time that they were doing this, Elijah was mocking them. After so long, no fire appeared. And then Elijah began to make statements that said, "Well, you need to holler a little louder. You know, maybe Baal, maybe he's meditating. Maybe he's busy. Maybe he took a journey. Maybe he's gone to sleep. Maybe he's taking a nap and you need to wake him up." So Elijah mocks these 400 and some odd, not counting the prophets of Astaroth, concerning all of what they were going through in trying to summons their God to send down fire and consume the sacrifice that they was offering. But nothing happens. And when it comes Elijah's turn, he takes 12 stones, each in representation of the 12 sons of Jacob, and he builds an altar. He makes a trench around the altar, large enough, as verse 32 says, to hold two sieves of grain or seed. I think the King James Version says two measures. You've got to realize this is a dry measurement, whatever this seat is. Being a dry measurement is not going to, of course, be as much as a liquid measurement would be. But from what I can understand, the two sheaves of seed, both of those amounted to about 3 gallons of seed. But again, we're talking about a dry measure. But still, anyway, he puts the wood in order, he cuts the bull in pieces, and he lays it on the wood. And then he fills four water pots with water. And he pours it on the burnt sacrifice. He pours it on the wood. And he repeats this a second time, and he does it a third time, so that water is running all around the altar, and it fills the trench that he dug with water. And with that, now being at the evening, time of the evening sacrifice, here's what Elijah says in verse 36. Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel, and I am your servant, and that I have done all of these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that you are the Lord God, and that you have turned their hearts back to you again. And so when Elijah finishes his speech in verse 38, here's what we see occurs. The fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust. And it licked up the water that was in the trench. I would like to have been there. For the prophets of Baal and Ashtaroth to have went all through their chantings and cutting of flesh and nothing to happen, and yet for Elijah to do what he did, and this happened to the extent that it happened. It just didn't consume the sacrifice. It consumed the wood, it consumed the stones, it consumed the dust, and it consumed the water. And all of this had been drenched in water from the beginning. What was the reaction of the people? Well, verse 39. Now when all of the people saw it, they fell on their faces and said, "The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God." So it should have been enough to convince them. And at the end of it, Elijah kills the prophets of Baal and Ashtaroth. And shortly thereafter, the drought is over. The rain begins to fall upon the earth. But it's in chapter 19 of 1 Kings that we see Elijah fleeing from Jezebel. You remember her. She is the wife of King Ahab. She was the daughter of the king of the Sidonians. And you remember the last part of his name was spelled B-A-A-L. So that tells us who Jezebel and all of her family were worshipers of. And we see why that the Baals have such an influence here in the kingdom of Israel under the reign of Ahab. So now she comes back into the picture. Because what happens after the events on Mount Carmel, the next day Jezebel threatens Elijah's life. And he flees to the south and crosses into Judah, the nation of Judah, the kingdom to the south. And Elijah is thinking himself to be a failure. You know, can you imagine going from what had to be an emotional high on that Mount Carmel to see the things that were done at the hand of God, to see the reaction of the people. Emotionally, I just don't see how you could have been any more enthusiastic. And yet now, the next day, his life is threatened that he's not going to live for 24 hours. And he's on the run. So we can see how easy it would be for him to have considered himself to be a failure. And not only that, but, you know, he was one against 850. There were no other prophets of God there on Mount Carmel. It was just Elijah, him. So we can see how it would be that he would think that he was the only one of God's prophets. So, feeling the way he felt concerning the events that had just happened and all for what? Now I'm running for my life. And I stood there alone. I must be the only prophet that God has. And what does he do? He prays for God to take his life. He prays to die. And God appears to him. And for those of you that have the outline, I put Mr. Horeb here. That's not a mister. That's Mount Horeb. Sorry about that. But God appears to him on Mount Horeb, the same mountain that God appeared to Moses on. There was wind, there was earthquake, and there was fire. But God did not speak. As awesome as those things, obviously, it said that the wind broke the rocks. That's just not a breeze. An earthquake. And fire. And yet God is not speaking through any of this. But finally, God speaks in a still, small voice. And he informs Elijah he is not alone. In fact, he tells Elijah that I have 7,000 prophets in Israel that have not bowed the knee to Baal. God then appoints Elijah to do three other things. He appoints him to anoint Hazael, king of Syria. He appoints Elijah to anoint Jehu, the next king of Israel. And he tells Elijah to anoint Elisha to succeed Elijah. And here is where it's easy to get confused. Elijah and Elisha, spelt very similar, pronounced very similar, but two different men, completely. Two different prophets, totally. So Elijah goes and he anoints Elisha, and for that period of time that Elijah still lives, Elisha is his servant. And after these events, in Elijah's life, he appears a few more times. In 1 Kings 21, we read where he confronts Ahab about his part in having Naboth killed so that he could obtain his vineyard. Remember, we studied that last week in our study of Ahab. We also see Elijah in 2 Kings chapter 1, where there he confronts King Ahaziah, which is Ahab's son, to inform him that he's not going to live long. So he's not going to reign the number anywhere near the number of years over Israel that his father Ahab reigned. And then we find Elijah in 2 Kings chapter 2. And that's where we see him being miraculously taken up to heaven in a chariot of fire. Now let's look at some lessons that we should make from all of this. We certainly should take away from Elijah the understanding that God takes care of his own. God fed, God protected Elijah when he needed it. And God will take care of us on the condition that we seek him first. That's what we see in the example of Elijah. He always sought to do God's will. And the result of that was that God watched over him. God cared. God protected. God took care of him. We know from Matthew 6 and verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto us. And that these things are back up in chapter 6 and the previous verses. What we shall drink, what we shall wear. These are the things that can and sometimes do occupy our priorities, become our priorities. But Jesus is saying the first priority needs to be seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And we know what God's righteousness is. Psalms 119, verse 172, all of God's commandments are righteousness. So if we seek first the kingdom, which we know is the church, and righteousness, which is the commandments of God, then we have this promise that God will provide all of these things unto us. And there's another interesting verse that doesn't, I think, get the attention that it needs, and that's found over in Psalms 37. In verse 25, where David said, I have been young and now am old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging bread. I think it would do us well to remember Psalms 37 and verse 25. It assures us that if we do God's will, he will take care of us. Another lesson we can learn from Elijah is that in the miracles that were performed, they were to confirm the word of God and to confirm the messenger who was performing the miracle. You remember in the instance of the widow that upon seeing her son brought back to life, she made that statement, by this, that is by my son being who was dead, returning back to me alive, by this I know you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord in your mouth is true. And the people at Mount Carmel, the miracle that was performed there, they initially believed because of that statement that they made that we read. The Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. So let's see, they initially believed. Because of the events, because of the miracles that took place there on Mount Carmel. Another lesson in spite of undeniable evidence, like on Mount Carmel, people's hearts may not change as we expect them to. Remember, I said a moment ago that had to have an effect upon Elijah. That had to be a part of his discouragement, of his asking God not to let him live. And you and I know full well that that is a source of discouragement to us, is when we talk and we talk and we teach and we teach, whether it's our family or our friends, the truth, and they just, and it's not that they don't know, they have to know the truth. They know the truth, you've told them the truth of what God's Word teaches. But then there's no real or no lasting results from it. Elijah was disappointed. The victory at Carmel did not completely and totally change Israel. It should have, but it didn't. And we should not be discouraged by a failure in our attempts to teach family and friends the gospel in hopes that they might obey. But here's one thing. We must always be assured that God's word will accomplish what he desires, and it will not return to God void. Regardless of the reaction or the non-reaction that people make, that we tell them the truth to, it's accomplishing what God intends for it to. Isaiah 55, verse 11, so shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing wherein I send it. Go to the book of Acts, and go to the missionary journeys that we have recorded of Paul, whether it was Paul and Barnabas or Paul and Silas. They go into a city. They preach the gospel. Some hear and obey. The same people that heard the same gospel seek Paul's life. See? Well, it accomplished what God intended for it to accomplish. It accomplished the separation of those that love the truth from those that don't love the truth. And remember what we're told in 2 Thessalonians, that those that don't have a love for the truth, God will send a strong delusion that they might believe a lie and be damned. Why? Because they don't love the truth. So whenever God's word is proclaimed, publicly, privately, whatever, it's going to accomplish something. And that's what we have see in Elijah. That's what we see all down through the prophets of the Old Testament. That's what we see all through the New Testament. And that's what we see today. This statement in Isaiah 55 is just as pertinent today as it's ever been. God's word will not return to him void. It will accomplish what God intends for it. Either love the truth and be saved, or have no love for the truth and be lost. Just like the Great Commission that Jesus gave. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. It's whether we believe or whether we believe not. Another lesson that we learn, we're not alone. And don't take this where we sometimes hear it, that we're not alone in the universe. There's life on other planets. No, don't take that statement that we're not alone in that context. There are others who believe as we do. And they are spiritual people with hearts ready to hear God's word. And what that ought to teach us is we mustn't never give up. We mustn't never give up trying to reach others with the gospel. Another lesson, God's message is not spread through great, noisy shows and campaigns. It's spread by individuals. See, remember, God didn't speak in the wind. As fascinating as it may have been, God didn't speak in the earthquake, which is an awesome display of power. God did not speak in the fire. But instead, God spoke in a voice. And the victory at Carmel did not achieve what Elijah thought that it would. But still, it was a display of God's word that he had spoken to Ahab and to all of Israel. We notice that passage in the New Testament that God has put his treasure in earthen vessels. That's human beings, that's you and me. That the power of God can be manifested. Another lesson is that we need duties and goals to keep us focused and to give our life purpose. You know, in Elijah's despair, God gave him a purpose. Go, anoint two kings, and anoint a successor. Remember, Jesus told his disciples, go into all the world and preach the gospel. See, God's purpose is served by the small things that we do daily, accomplishing the task God gives us to do to the very best of our ability. Our life's work may not be told. It may just be told in only six chapters, like Elijah. You know, when you think of it, and the great prophet that he was, but when you think about it, there are just six chapters that we read about Elijah. So, our work may be told in only six chapters, but we can have an impact. We can change the world, not by great campaigns, but by one person at a time, starting with ourselves. So in conclusion of our study, to really sort of condense what we learned from Elijah, I think we might could reduce it to this. Prayer has power. We know that from James 5, where Elijah prayed and the heavens were stopped. Again, Elijah prayed and the heavens gave forth rain. But the verse before, verses 16 and 17, is verse 15. I'm sorry, verses 17 and 18, the verse 16 is the verse that says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. So that's one way to condense it. The other condensing is depression has a solution. And we see what the solution was in Elijah's case. Get up and go do something. Why are you here? Was the question that God asked Elijah. Why are you here? What are you doing? Elijah got up and did what God told him to do. And the third thing is God sustains. And that's very obvious in the story of Elijah. Elijah is mentioned in the New Testament 30 times. And many of them have to do with Christ. And the two well-known references that we have of Elijah and Jesus are John the Baptist would come in the spirit and the power of Elijah. Luke 1 verse 17, as the forerunner. John was the forerunner of Christ. And Jesus himself confirmed that John fulfilled the prophecy that the Jews held that Elijah would come to prepare the way for the Messiah. Matthew 17 verse 12. And the other reference is when Elijah appears with Jesus and Moses on the Mount of Transfiguration. 1 minute. First bell. And that we read, of course, in the accounts of Matthew 17, Mark 9, and Luke 9. Elijah, the influential prophet that he was, he never wrote a book. He sprang out of the Bible pages in 1 Kings 17, 1, when he tells Ahab that God will punish sinful Israel with a drought. We don't know anything about his parents. He departs from the scene about 20 years later, as mysteriously as he arrives, when he's taken up into heaven in a chariot of fire. And I made another mistake on your papers. I said taken up into the heavens. It's not the heavens. It's taken up into heaven. So make sure you make that notation. His story is told in only 6 chapters in the Old Testament, but his influence extends into the New Testament. And in his message of repentance, he is a pattern for John the Baptist, as Malachi prophesied in chapter 4 and verse 5, and as Matthew 11 and verse 14, when John said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And he told all of those that came to him the things they needed to do, the changes they needed to make. That was John the Baptist. And certainly we see how truly the statement is that John came in the spirit and in the power of Elijah. And he appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration with Moses and Jesus. James, there in that 17th verse, says that he was a man of like passions as we are. A lot of people think of Elijah as an angel. Elijah wasn't no angel. He was a prophet. He was a man. A man with a nature like ours. And we know that because in what we see, Elijah alternates from great faith to the depths of despair. And I think there are times in our lives that we reach those highs and those lows. Elijah was just a man with a nature like ours. Lord willing, next Wednesday we will look at his successor, Elisha. So appreciate so much our time, our study, and I trust that we all have been able to benefit and learn from the lessons from one of God's greatest prophets that we read about. Thank you so much.